Well, let's take a look first at the Health Ministry figures released today on the number of COVID cases in India. We can see there that we have now crossed the 20,000 milestone, more than 20,000 cases now in India. And an important statistic to remember here is that these cases were just 10,000 just 8 days ago. So in the span of about a week or so, we've doubled from 10 to 20,000 cases. India is the 17th country in the world with more than 20,000 cases. Currently, in the last 24 hours, there were 49 people who died as a result of COVID, and more than 1,480 cases were reported from across the country. Now, looking at how different cities are doing in the country, these are six cities with more than 500 cases. And these six account for 45% of the cases in the country. We are hearing that special containment plans are being discussed for districts which have hotspots. So there might be some new rules that come your way as far as these specific containment areas are concerned. But almost half of the country's COVID cases come from these six cities. Meanwhile, struggling with the economic blow of the lockdown, industry has been asking the government to help with another big bailout. However, nothing has come forward yet. Government ministers have told NDTV this could take some time given the huge financial constraints of the centre as well. The cabinet has also cleared an ordinance today on insolvency and bankruptcy, which will not allow any company to go bankrupt for the next 6 months or a period specified by the government. Earlier, a stimulus package of 1.7 lakh crores had been announced by the government for the economy, but all industry bodies say that that is just not enough. Now, another important thing that companies have brought to the notice of the government in the last 24 hours is that company managements can actually be punished or penalized under the law if an employee tests positive for COVID-19. Now, these are according to guidelines issued by the Home Ministry. It's a rule that has worried many in industry who see it as an overreach, making it difficult to come back to work, frankly. The government tweeted a clarification today, but effectively ended up saying the same thing, that penalties are applicable if the offence occurs with the consent or negligence of the employer. And this has to be determined at the local level by district magistrates. Clause 21, which is what the government cited in the tweet today, says that penalties shall be levied against those who are found to be violating directives relating to social distancing and the SOPs laid down by the government. Now, there are a whole host of SOPs, standard operating procedures, that have been laid out by the government for those industries that have to go back to work. How much of these are doable? Well, such as disinfecting all areas, such as lifts, gates, etc. Special transport for workers who are coming from outside with 30 to 40% passenger capacity. Medical insurance for workers to be made mandatory, an hour gap between shifts, staggered lunch breaks for staff, and discouraging large meetings at least of 10 or more people. Well, we have two leading captains of industry joining us on NDTV this evening. Mr. Sunil Munjal, the chairman of Hero Enterprise, joins us. Dr. Naushad Forbes, the former president of CII, also with us this evening. Mr. Munjal, thanks for being with us. First of all, are you disappointed that we haven't got that big second stimulus package that industry has really been hoping for? And are you hopeful that maybe it does come in the next few days?
Yes. Yes to both. First, it is, I think, a little bit late. And I do believe that the government has been struggling with trying to balance the books, but the numbers with how much they can spend right away and how much they can spend over a period of time. The industry is hurting already because the revenues have been down now for a while. And most companies have kept people on. They're paying salaries. They have other operating costs. They have rentals. So it is a little bit of a challenge. And the impact of the pandemic is expected on the economy to stay on for about 18 to 24 months. So certainly the industry in all sectors will need some support.
And how much support are you? Are you in that general agreement with that one has been reading about from various industry body statements about 9, 10 lakh crores or thereabouts? Is that the kind of stimulus that is required?
So I would say yes. I have two other views on this. I think we need to stop worrying for a while about inflation and our rating, because these are the two things which also hold us back naturally. And I think the inflation is so low and is likely to remain low for a while that we should be able to print more money and get it directly to where it's required, to people, to companies, so that the economic activity cannot just be sustained, but can also begin to grow at least a small, low pace right now. The other thing I think which is important is to be able to use the RBI's rupee and dollar reserves creatively. Both of these things, I think, can be done. So going back to your question of how much this the package cost. Should be, yeah. At this moment, we've done less than 1% of India's GDP. Most countries have done between 5 to 20%. So even if we do 4 or 5%, we will be towards the lower end of what's being done by most countries across the globe.
Well, Mr. Naushad Forbes, the other sort of big talking point, as I was saying just before this, are, you know, the government guidelines on getting industries back to work slowly. Among them now, these penalties that could be imposed on the management if, you know, people actually test positive for COVID-19. Is this a big concern that you have, that this is just not practical and that this definitely needs to change?
Well, I think it needs to change and will change, but I do believe that the priority at present is really getting back to work, number one. And number two, it's really from companies, it's to keep our own members safe. You know, the intention obviously is to keep our own members safe regardless of what the guidelines are. That's the top priority of every company. I think some of these penalties, et cetera, are not well placed. I think we can operate on the basis of trust to a much greater extent. Let me say that from the perspective of our own organization, we've been given permission to start in a limited way. We've gone ahead and started. We've gone on the basis that we will follow all of the protocols that have been laid down and more, because our goal is to keep our own members safe, regardless of what the actual guidelines might be. Our top priority is that. If I can come to the point that you asked Sunil earlier on about the package, I think, first of all, it's important to see it not as a stimulus package, but as a support package. The package that we're talking about, we've made some recommendations for CII 2 weeks ago, and I want to talk about that, and there are two relevant parts to it. One is the content of the package. Second is the timing. The content of the package, the key piece in the package, is support for people at the lower strata of society, so people who are self-employed, the informal sector that has been particularly badly hit by the slowdown that we've seen. You've seen literally, I think the numbers from CMIE are that 150 million people have lost their jobs in this last 6 weeks. Out of the 150 million, the overwhelming number are from the informal sector. That's where you need very direct and immediate input,
yes,
and support. Yeah. And then the second is for all enterprises. And we say support all enterprises with 3 months' wages in the form of loans through the banking system, backed up by a government guarantee through the RBI. And the reason we are recommending this is that you lend out at 4 to 5% interest. So you lend out at more or less the same rate that banks borrow from the RBI at. So you're not talking about a subsidy. We're not talking about an interest subvention even. We're just talking about 3 months' wages that would enable companies to keep people employed. Because if we can keep everyone employed, then we're really enabling a much quicker and more efficient and quicker recovery. And what I can't understand, the last point, is the fact that it's taken so long. I mean, you know, you started by saying we're waiting for this package. Yes, we are waiting for this package. It's 2 weeks since we submitted this recommendation, and I don't know why it is we've not seen anything yet happen. I think it's a terrible thing.
And look, well, you know, you're being frank about that. We don't know, you know, whether that package is going to come soon. We're hearing that it may still take some more time. So, Mr. Munjal, I think the question then is that are layoffs inevitable? I mean, is that the unfortunate reality that is staring at us in the next couple of months?
So it would really be unfortunate, but you're right that the beyond a point, companies, especially small companies, will find it hard to sustain their operations if they have no revenues and also no support coming. And I believe there are some companies which have already begun to either lay off people or tell them that you're not getting any payment now for a while, the social fallout of this will be very hard for us to manage. We are already managing a difficult situation with migrant labor at shelters across the many, many states in India. That's another issue which is going on. If companies start to lay off people, that would actually compound the situation, and the situation overall is bad enough. So I actually sympathize with the government. It's a very hard time to be in governance at this time. To be fair to them, governments responded very quickly across the country. Governments, local administrations, central government, state governments, in terms of what we did to protect the India and Indians. In that respect, I have to say full marks to them. But I think it's equally important that the economic pandemic is not allowed to have the same impact which the health pandemic
could. Or a worse impact. I have a quick last question, Mr. Forbes, which is, also on the way industry is allowing you being allowed to restart, again, coming to these sort of guidelines that are in place. Now, you know, today we heard about permission being given to the Maruti plant in Manesar, just outside Delhi, to restart work there with thousands of workers, etc., with all the SOPs in place. But as we heard from insiders there, it's not that simple to just go back to work, because you don't have the components, you don't have the supply chains, you don't have sales happening. It's not that they can just start manufacturing overnight. So these are genuine bottlenecks that industry is going to face. And in a sense, would you say that we need to think of a way to relook at the stringent sort of lockdown that is there, and quickly?
So, we are where we are. We're at the position where we've had this very stringent lockdown. So we need to restart from where we are. And given that the coordination when we went into the lockdown left a lot to be desired. You know, there were notifications that came out from Delhi that were implemented very differently at the individual state levels and very variably at the different state levels. And as we unwind the lockdown, as we restart the economy, we need to do it in a much smoother and more effective way. And the mechanism that we've recommended is a joint committee that includes some ministers at the central government level, it includes secretaries at the central government level, and then it includes state chief secretaries, such that this body can actually meet on a daily basis and address any of those issues that come up as we unwind the lockdown and get back to work. These are things that are going to come up every single day. There'll be a logistics issue here, there'll be an issue with getting truck drivers there, there'll be an issue with the suppliers needing to restart their own operations. There'll be an issue with transporting people to work in another place. Yeah. There are a variety of issues that will come up, and we need to be able to deal with them on a real-time, daily basis.
All right. Let's hope that things do get better and that we see a further lifting of restrictions after the 3rd of May, provided that the virus isn't out of control, as it were. One last question, Mr. Munjal. I wanted to ask you about these tough guidelines, especially on these penalties. Would you urge the government to reconsider this? Because, I mean, how can you hold management responsible for people who get infected? It also stigmatizes people who get infected, and that's not the aim.
First, we have to remember this is a health situation. It's a disease and it's an infection which will get people. And there's no way for any management to be able to predict who is going to get it. It will happen in our homes as well. It will happen across the country. The moment we start to open up, the spread will happen. And we have to expect that at some point we need the herd immunity to set in. That means we need 60 to 65% of the population to have got some kind of infection for us to become immune to it, like we are to mumps and measles and other such diseases. But the guidelines have to be voluntary. I think companies are quite responsible. You've allowed them self-certification in all kinds of government documents. This is the least we should be doing, because please remember, companies are an equal responsible player and a citizen right now, and are working shoulder to shoulder with government in supporting the entire system, making it work. Even when companies were shut down,
right,
most companies are helping not just their own people, but the communities and people
and
societies around them.
I think it's what Mr. Forbes said about trust, so, that a lot of this going forward will depend upon the trust between the government, its citizens, responsible citizens,
absolutely.
Certainly.
And we have to remember, a company can only open when its entire value chain opens. When the dealer opened, the workshop opened, distributor opened, every supplier opened, and the supplier's suppliers opened. So it is a complex situation. So we should not burden it further by putting penal provisions where people are trying to do the right thing.
Thank you very much to both of you for joining us this evening, Mr. Munjal, Mr. Forbes, giving us your perspective. Let's hope the government is listening to some important suggestions that you've both made, and that we do see that stimulus package that industry is asking for, better late than never, as they say, to use that cliche. Well, we are seeing, interestingly, at this time, as India deals with this pandemic, by and large, political unity in this country, though there have been some criticisms from time to time from opposition parties. We have former Union Law Minister and Rajya Sabha MP Kapil Sibal joining us this evening. And Mr. Sibal, you've also been trying to give some constructive suggestions through your columns, including having, as you put it, a national action plan to deal with COVID. Now, what do you mean by that? Because we already seem to, I mean, we do see the Prime Minister collaborating with chief ministers. He's been meeting them regularly via video conference. What would the national plan be that would be different from what's currently happening?
No, actually, the national plan that I was talking about is a plan that is envisaged by the National Disaster Management Act. In fact, if something as calamitous as this happens, the act prescribes the government to have a national plan at the national level, a state plan at the state level, and all the states will have separate plans because the demographics and the nature of the state is different. And you will also have a plan at the district level. And it's the coordination between the center, the state, and the districts that you deal with a pandemic like this. Unfortunately, our government doesn't have a national plan because they've never actually implemented the act.
So you're saying that are you saying that the coordination is not good enough, that it's still too uncoordinated?
No, there is no plan. There is no national plan. Otherwise, the Prime Minister would have told us about it. The Home Minister would have told us about it. The Secretaries to the Government of India would have told us about it. All that we are getting are notifications by the National Executive Council, the head of which is the Secretary of the Ministry of Home Affairs. And he is giving directions or advisories to the rest of the country. This is completely unbelievable.
See, there's a lot of discretion being left to states because health is also a state subject. You don't think it works better that way with each state's unique problems?
No. Unfortunately not, because the National Disaster Management Act obliterates all functions of the state. Actually, it overrides all acts prior to this. So, in fact, it says only the disaster. So, let me just explain to you. Under the national plan will tell us what monies are to be given to those who are affected, what kind of minimum standards for shelter, for food, for amenities, for sanitation, for drinking water, what kind of relief is to be given to businesses. This is all part of the national plan, which is reflected in the National Disaster Management Act.
Okay, so you're saying a one-point nodal person. Are you surprised that that big stimulus package that industry is so desperately asking for, especially for small and medium businesses, that's still not come?
I'm absolutely not just surprised. I'm amazed as to why it hasn't come. You see, the real priority with this government ought to be on the demand side. In other words, you must get money into the hands of the poor. And there are 800 million of them who actually live from hand to mouth. Now you need to make sure that they get at least 10,000 rupees into their account. Then only from the demand side, people will start buying. If you give industry a stimulus package and there is no demand occurring, what are they going to do? It's like this. It's, for example, if you have an industry has an inventory, which is already full, and you give credit facilities to that industry, what is the industry going to do with that credit? Because the inventory is full, there's no demand, there's no production then, because the inventory is full. So unless the inventory goes out, that will happen only when there's demand, then only will production start. So I don't know, they are dealing with it on the supply side, they're not dealing with it on the demand side.
Can I ask you though, finally, what is your overall assessment of how this is being handled by the government? Look, by and large, the world thinks we've done a good job. Bill Gates says we've done a good job. What do you think?
See, I don't want to really criticize what kind of job you've done or not, but you've not done the job that is envisaged under the National Disaster Management Act to deal with a disaster like this. And I'm afraid that bureaucrats sitting in the Government of India and his Ministry of Home Affairs do not know the reality on the ground. They do not know how to handle the situation. This is the problem. And all you right. cannot have uniform regulations, uniform advisories all over the country for every state. In America, for example, industry is being allowed to function, and industry is being allowed to determine as to what extent it will function. Now, you give a direction that only 25% of industry can function. Well, if it's a seamless plant which has to run 100%, how will 25% work?
Exactly.
Then the supply chain comes from somewhere else, where there's a lockdown. How will the supplies come?
And that's what voices from industry were actually saying just before you came on. That was exactly the concern that they were flagging as well. Mr. Sibal, thanks for joining us with that perspective tonight. Constructive criticism, perhaps, for a change from the opposition, which is good to see. There are some suggestions the government does listen to time to time, including those investments from China. But let me get Mr. Rakesh Sinha, Rajya Sabha MP of the BJP, in to give us the ruling party's perspective on this. And Mr. Sinha, first of all, you may have just heard captains of Indian industry, not just Mr. Sibal as an opposition leader, but very eminent captains of industry saying that we need that stimulus package. It should have come for industry, especially for small and medium industries. Why hasn't it come until now?
Before coming to that, I have one observation on Kapil Sibal's remark. The way he was describing the disaster situation, in fact, he is ruining the cooperative federalism. Narendra Modi government is trying to sustain the cooperative federalism at this juncture when center can take any power. It can declare a national emergency. Many nations have declared national emergency, but this government has refrained from declaring national emergency. And with the cooperation of the people, it is the people of India which is cooperating with the government. That government is successful. That's why Indian model is being praised. Prime Minister Narendra Modi's visionary action. Timely action, right time, right action. And with a soft coercion. There's no hard coercion on the people, those who are violating the law. And now the government has come with an ordinance, which is for those people who are violating and attacking on the health workers. As far as opposition is concerned, that's ridiculous. You remember, Nidhi, in the beginning, I don't want to name one opposition leader, they said that Modi is talking about the corona just to divert attention from the ground realities, from the real issues.
But now leaving the opposition aside, Mr. Sinha, I'm only asking you what industry is asking for. Let's talk about solutions. Because industry is saying we need about 5% of India's GDP to be spent on a rescue package for us. We need to be able to pay salaries for the next 3 months or people will lose their jobs. Would you urge the government, would you take that plea to the government? They've also been sent their representations to the government that we need an urgent intervention right now.
You know, any constructive suggestion by the industry would be considered by the government, but the government has been taking very, very constructive measures for the revival of the industry. That's 1 lakh crore, more than 1 lakh crore package for MSMEs. And you know, 90 days moratorium for all liabilities. Income tax returns have received by them. Most of the income tax returns they received. And moreover, the government is taking flexible measures. The RBI is taking actions. So here the priority is first to combat corona. Second step is the revival of the economy, and the government is doing parallel steps. I am giving two examples. The challenges before the government are twin. One is the revival of the industry, of course. Second is the poor people, the needy people, unemployed people. And I'm giving that in Jan Dhan Yojana, the 500 rupees reached to the every person who is holder of this account. And this
Mr. Sinha, 500
to
rupees
more.
Is nothing. 500 rupees.
I'm telling you.
It's very little.
Yes, I say that this is little, but not only that. 1.70 lakh crore for the Garib Kalyan, Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. 80 crore people are getting additional 5 kg weight rice.
But Mr. Sinha, the point is that both people who are working with the poor on the ground, both industry captains, they're all saying that while the steps taken so far are welcome, such as the PDS distribution of ration, which was welcomed, I think what everybody is saying is that we need to do more. And I think we also understand that the government has certain financial constraints, but that this is an extraordinary time and the government needs to do more. Can I ask you, though, very quickly, you know, on the government MHA guidelines on industries as they go back to work, I was just asking industry captains about that, that, you know, company managers will be penalized if somebody tests positive for COVID. Do you think that this should be changed, Mr. Sinha?
You know, Nidhi, COVID is not a normal disease. One person infected means it can infect 1 crore people. This can, because...
But how is the company manager responsible
This is a deterrence. This is not a punishment. Such kind of law are considered a deterrence. This makes you conscious, both employees and employer. You have to conscious. You have to get tested. You have to maintain the social distancing. You have to avoid all the...
You can still get it. You don't know who you meet on your way to work. What companies are saying is that this will deter them from actually coming back to work. You're right. It's deterrence, but of a different kind.
Nidhi, we are a soft state. And being a soft state, we know that how the health workers are being attacked, how social distancing is violated. So in that case, if you are not going by such law, India would be in real in peril. Narendra Modi has saved India from falling in the peril. You see the condition of Italy, you see the condition of New York and America, you see the condition of other Western developed countries.
But we're not those countries. I think that's the point. That is the point. But Mr. Sinha, I'm out of time. Thank you for giving us your perspective. At least one hopes that you can use your influence within the party to request them to look at these stimulus packages, both for the poor, for industry, for small and medium industries in particular, so that people are not laid off in the next few months. Thanks very much for joining us. That's it on the show this evening. Sanket is up next with much more.